Okay, we're ready to go. Good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to the Foreign Correspondents Club of Japan. I'm Dennis Nurmile, and I'll be the MC this afternoon. Before we get started, please join me in the usual routine of making sure that your cell phones are turned off or turned to manner mode. We're quite honored today to have one of Japan's, actually one of the world's, most distinguished architects as our guest. He's a graduate of the University of Tokyo and the Harvard Graduate School of Design in Cambridge, Massachusetts. He has taught architecture and urban design at Harvard, Washington University in St. Louis, the University of Tokyo, Keio University, and has lectured extensively all over the world. Even if you don't follow architecture closely, you almost certainly know some of this man's buildings. They include the Spiral Building near Omotesando Station, the Tokyo Metropolitan Gymnasium in Sendagaya, and the TV Asahi headquarters in Roppongi. And one project that I'll mention in particular is the Hillside Terrace and other hillside buildings in the Daikanyama district of Tokyo. What's quite remarkable about these is that they are resolutely modern buildings, and yet they're of a scale that fits in with the neighborhood. They add to the neighborhood. They do not overwhelm their surroundings. And that's a key point that we'll be coming back to. One of his most notable international works was just completed last fall, and that is the Four World Trade Center on the site of the Old World Trade Center in New York City. For his body of work, he won the 1993 Pritzker Prize, which is considered by many to be the Nobel Prize of Architecture. So when it comes to architecture and urban design, this is a man who knows what he's talking about. And lately, he's been talking about Tokyo's ambitious, he might say overly ambitious, building plans for the 2020 Olympics. As I think everyone knows, the city has promised to spend over 400 billion yen building 22 new Olympic venues and refurbishing a number of older facilities. And the centerpiece of these plans and the focus of much of the criticism is the main stadium, which is designed by Zaha Hadid, a London-based architect, at nearly 290,000 square meters. It would be by far the biggest main stadium in the history of the Olympic Games. Our guest and several other leading architects have been pointing out that the design is simply too massive. It is very costly, poses a number of engineering challenges, and would overwhelm the Jingu Gaien area in which it is to be built. And so to hear more about the criticism and what chances there are for revising these plans, please join me in welcoming Mr. Fumihiko Maki.
Thank you. Should I start?
Yeah.
Thank you very much for a nice introduction. And I'm very honored to speak at FCCJ this afternoon. I would like to start with chronological development of this thing. First, the result of international competition announced November last 2002, so almost 2 years ago. Then my essay came out in Japan Institute of Architects magazine in Japanese, August 15th last year. Then in Buenos Aires, as you know, Tokyo was selected to be to host Olympic 2020, September 8th. Now, this magazine expresses the concerns on the bulk of a project and safety and also cost, not only for building itself, but also maintaining the building, etc. I wanted to publish this essay before Buenos Aires is announced, because had Tokyo been not selected to be Olympic, my essay published would receive a comment, well, your worry was not there. So I wanted to give particular attention to a process of arriving this project, more than design itself. And there are some inherent problems for a decision-making process in Japan for such a project, so which I wanted to point out. And but after the this project was shown to public right after the competition, there's not much responses in terms of location or sizes or et cetera. Why? Because the competition was held before the hosting city was decided. So there aren't enough interest among Japanese. Or some people felt if you make negative comment, it might not help to bring the Olympic to Tokyo. So there's absolute silence. But I was alarmed by the size of this stadium on this particular site, on which I'd like to explain a little bit more later. The reason I was astounded was I was the one who designed this Tokyo gymnasium way back 23 years ago. Then I could compare immediately enormous size of this one in relation to what we have done. The project we've done, Tokyo Gymnasium, was to make twice bigger in floor area than the one which had existed before. In 1950s, there was some athletic conference in Asia, and they had a two boxy building, one the gymnasium, the other the swimming pool, etc. And what we even asked was to make twice bigger than the previous one in the floor area and the spectator numbers, but not allowed to make the building higher than previous one, and also do not exceed the volume above the ground. So we try to negotiate those conditions also with surroundings. And much of the gymnasium, which contains 8,000 spectators, and also swimming pool, are put under the ground level in terms of volume, and then try to make this place a little bit more humane. And also we are concerned with existing building scale, et cetera, et cetera. So we try to put this gymnasium on this side to mitigate impact of the volume from neighborhood. And so also this area happened to be one of the places which you know Meiji Jingu, we call Inner Court, and the Meiji Gaien Outer Court, with Shinjuku Gyoen, the big park just on north, and Crown Prince and the Princess live on this place. And you could also see the Aoyama Cemetery. So it's a very well developed with greenery in Tokyo. Not any other places you can find with such an extent of greenery. And suddenly having to build building in this manner might be very questionable. We don't know who decided to have a 2020 Olympic main stadium on this site. But as we recall, 2016, Tokyo did not succeed to have Olympic. The one of the reasons that IOC criticized the main stadium having on the waterfront might be too far away. So this might have stayed in their mind. So this time they proposed to have this main stadium on this site. But since we don't have too much time, I'm not going into more history of this area. But again, you could see the red one indicate the size of the new national stadium. And this is a collage we made out of the picture taken from air by one of my friends. And you see gymnasium here, and also very important, yes, the museum to house the paintings of Meiji period. You see, all this complex was built right after the Meiji emperor passed away. And people decided for the memory of his tremendous achievement in modernization of Japan to have this Meiji Jingu, and also the this outer complex. But from the beginning, they designated this could be one of the sports centers for Tokyo. So this is the reason why we have a rugby stadium, baseball stadium, and main stadium right now. But not to you could now see from another direction the this outer court, and where the main actor of the court is to the museum and the long stretch of the Esplanade. And many of you must have always see this view from Aoyama Street. And it's one of very few Tokyo Baroque sort of scenery. And then you could see few gymnasiums or athletic facilities cluster along this side. And the Tokyo gymnasium I built was once the Tokugawa's estate. And area demarcated by dotted blue is a place to designate scenery important zones where the height and the volume of the building must be restricted in order to give a honor to this museum, etc. And now you could see this scene of the museum from here, this side. And people who designed and built this was very proud of that at the time when it was completed. Nothing like this in Tokyo. So we have to keep this very, very important. And as I remember, whenever somebody tries to build a higher building behind, there is a very severe criticism or review by Tokyo Metropolitan Government. So now, as you see it, this particular view of the new national stadium with this kaigakan, we say, the museum, shows they must have completely ignored kind of a necessary relationship between the two objects and others. But I must not, or I have not criticized the design so much. Instead, my criticism goes to a program. Why such a huge gymnasium was necessary? So I went into a competition brief and found out and also through newspapers, I found out the process. Now you can make a quick comparison between the three projects. One, our Tokyo Metropolitan Gymnasium, Yoyogi National Museum, very famous masterpiece of this kind of facility, designed by Kenzo Tange, and this new national stadium. But when you look at site area, Yoyogi had 9.1 hectares, whereas National Museum or Stadium, 11 hectares, only 2 hectares. But yet, the capacity, they ask for 80,000 people to accommodate, and while Yoyogi, only 15,000, he said. Now, after Buenos Aires, quiet media suddenly became interested in, because the concern we expressed becoming reality. And when we had a symposium in one of the places near stadium, which has a 300 seating capacity, 100 people from media as well. And one of them, Tokyo Shimbun, made front page for this, saying this new stadium is too big, it's Tokyo Shimbun. And here is my name. This is the first time and last time my name would appear in the front page of newspaper, because I'm not a politician. So, but yet, this shows the concern even the media expressed. And while I was a little bit disappointed by a silence of this matter before Buenos Aires came, but after the Buenos Aires, there are many, many people coming out to express their concern similar to mine. You can look at the stadium built for Olympic in Beijing And this is probably their biggest stadium for Olympic. And also it was result of competition and won by Swiss architect Herzog and Mueller. But in this case, there is enough frontal space. So if you don't like, you don't have to take a look so much. You can just pass by. And I think this is a kind of a rule of game. If you are going to build a huge building, you should have enough sort of open space around it. Because in the European continent, some of the monuments are not necessarily to be appreciated for ages by people. So having this kind of residual space, also for the safety, must have been very important. But unfortunately, the site they chose for our national stadium doesn't have this kind of open space. And probably street would come just right in the front of a mass. The height of this project happens to be similar to our stadium. And you could see the enormous mass, whatever they are in design, and size of people. So you could imagine if this stadium is going to be built, then the relationship between the human being and the object are very telling by this one. And today, I just happened to be in Beijing a month ago to give a talk. They don't like it, and they don't use it anymore. And only this is a place for tourists. And they must come, or this is a place for Olympic, and 8 years ago, and so on. So the problem is first, why we have chosen this site. But as I mentioned before, there must be a reason they like to appeal to IOC. And also, having a competition before the host city was selected is to show we are so eager to have a beautiful building to be a place for Olympic, which might have some appeal, this is my personal opinion, to them, because IOC people, not architects or engineers, they simply saw it's a good gesture by Japanese. Now you can take a look on the breakdown of facilities. In London, Sydney, Athens, to house 8,000 spectators, they required only 100,000 square meters. But why this one happened to be 219,000? They put many other things like hospitality, but hospitality is only necessarily for Olympic, not in later. And also museum, library, related operation, etc. This is also not necessarily to be with the gymnasium or stadium. But you see, when the Olympic, some people like take advantage of that moment to say, oh, we like to have this, that. There must be a certain pressure from professional athletic organizations, politicians, etc. So, at the end, it became 290,000 square meters. It's the biggest stadium to be built on a very narrow site. You can compare those figures and realize how big the places are. For instance, in London, you had 8,000 spectators there, but on the site, 1.5 times bigger than Tokyo, Athens, Sydney, much bigger site, like Beijing. And existing National Museum, capacity of 54,000 and smaller site, but more fitting into the site. And so why we had to build such a big facilities in narrow site? This goes back to a process of arriving at this figure. It is not the architect's figure. Architects only comply with whatever given to a program. And in Japan, when you make important decision, there's expert meetings organized. But often the expert meetings are composed of people who would not oppose to government intentions. And in this case, about 15 experts, but only one architect and planner. And the rest of them, all government or sports-related people. So they, according to newspaper, Tokyo Shimbun, published at the end of this year, they first meeting was held before the competition. And already there, we like to have 80,000, we like to have a roof place, and why not for music? Why not this place for Broadway? I think it was a joke, but anyway, such mood must have prevailed to decide the program for a competition. And so now this is the size of the bulk of the stadium to house 80,000 spectators place. Then rest of the facilities, I just show you. Museum and the libraries, the hospitality, etc., must be come around here. Have the bigger site. You could have those facilities in here, but you couldn't do it. So they had to pile up from underground to top with all those facilities, which made the building bulkier and more expensive. You know, this original program asked 900 parking places, but since they could not accommodate outside, they are put all underground. And in Japan, digging deep into a site is very costly. You have all kind of ramps and et cetera, et cetera. And so to me, the wrong decision is already there. Then I just go quickly on competition brief, which I found many doubts. First, eligibility is to architects who have experiences in designing stadium larger than 15,000 feet. This is quite common, you know, when you have a competition on the library. Have you done any library before? How big and how soon it was, etc. But then asking some prize recipients to be exempted from this rule of game seems to be very, very strange. It also saying we are not interested in ordinary architects. We are only interested in named architects. And I think this is a kind of insult to architectural community. And so, but also the other strange thing is they have never asked to submit three-dimensional models. I have done many jury as well in all over the world. And we always ask the models to be submitted in order to see how it could be fit onto the site or surroundings. And also, strangely enough, they did not ask any perspective to be seen from ground floor level, which normally people would see, recognize the building. And only bird's eye view. That's the reason when first announcement or images came out last 2 years ago, they only show how it looks. Oh, now sushi, you could say pretty well on how good sushi would be from that angle. But not in the architecture. Architecture requires kind of a view from street level. Some people just jogging, people giving newspapers, just passerby, and etc. But they have completely ignored. They're not interested in those materials for judgment. This is a view of Panathinaikos Stadium I saw many years ago, almost 60 years ago, and I was struck by the beauty of this. And this is a place where the original Olympic took place many years ago. And even when there was an Olympic or Athens, 1980s, this place was used for additional facility. And it fits into urban design of Athens. But this is a Zaha Hadid submitted competition she won in Basel. I happened to be doing a project in Basel, I knew. But this was rejected by a citizens' referendum, never built, much smaller and more modest one. There is, in Switzerland, there is a, it's a civil society and wanted to see how it could be judged by people who may have to pay a tax on cost. Then, this is a small pavilion I did in Netherlands, 1996. It's one of the Hanseatic cities, so extensive canal could bring those boat or floating pavilion to be for city. And it's pushed by a tugboat, but it's now moored, so it became a place for dancing or performance. Then, 10 years ago, I received a letter from unknown citizens. They said, we like to keep this, but after roof was damaged, the city decided to abolish. But in Holland, if the public project, no matter how small it is, objected such act by an architect, they could not do it. So please write to city, the architects object to this fate. And I did a letter. And a few years later, I received from people in the city, it's a good news. We now have a budget. We can revitalize. You see, in a civil society, you have people have a right to say on to build or to abolish. But in a governed society, it is not. So, but basically, our governed society started in the Edo period with the samurai as a ruling class. And after modernization of Japan in the Meiji period, the samurai class was replaced by bureaucrats. And never we have experience in a kind of a sound civil society for in the process of making this kind of important decisions. And of course, in today when we have many small projects in the cities, there's a more active citizens' participation. But in this case, it was a national project. So perhaps the government might have taken advantage of that and only organized this expert meeting to make the whole process justified. Now, as you know, a new estimate came in, and instead of 3 billion, they reduced project to 1.7 or 8 billion. And but yet, that size is still too big for us, or for city, as I explained you late, before. And also, in order to keep this facility going soundly, after the Olympic, they estimated the source of income in the following way. With the Sosa 20 days, rugby 5 days, field track events 11 days, and culture. Only, to, you see, IOC is not asking any covered stadium because track athletic activity must be done in open air. So this was things decided by Japanese people. And they said, well, if we can have a covered, we can have a big rock concert, but not so many in this place. And so they estimate only. So almost 300 days in a year is empty for this park. Now, the time is running out. Huh? Okay, 5 minutes.
For
WTC,
for
we quicker. Well, you see, I'm always concerned with the humane environment is to be built for a building. And I just wanted to show you quickly WTC completed partially last year. And as you know, our tower 4 is here. And second, third are not being built. And the one first and the fourth one is now under construction. And this was just completed very lately. And it's a very abstract, minimalist expression. And this is a view looking at from Fifth Avenue Extension direction. You can see it. But in the front, we have a memorial park. And the people come for some time seeing the names they are familiar with. And so we try to make this part very open. And evening, they have a welcome sign. And this is a view of ribbon cutting day, November 13th. But what I wanted to say is that the memorial park are the three basic natures: trees, water, and sky. So at the end of elevator corridor, we also have sky, trees, and water. It's a media art. So you could see certain rapport between the memorial park, and we have organized in the interior. This black granite wall could act like a mirror to reflecting all memorial park scenery. And as you move into that, you could see those sort of. And when you come back from inside to lobby, then you could see a memorial park. So it seems to me in architecture, it requires a certain empathy between the building itself and also the surrounding. But unfortunately, this big stadium is not a museum, office building, or anything. It is a huge civil engineer product, like elevated highway. And it becomes very difficult for architects to cope to satisfy those conditions, I know. That's piece. And this is a view taken from the Rockefeller Center with the Empire State Building, and our number 4 and the number 1 is rising. And so that's my talk. Thank you very much.
Okay, we'll move right into Q&A. Questions from the working press first. Right here. Please give your name and affiliation.
My name is Hiro Kishitan. I'm with the Kokumin Shimbun, editorial writer. Kokumin Shimbun was the number one shimbun in the pre-war years. And it was founded 1890 by Tokutomi Soho. And I was shocked to learn your presentation, from your presentation, that the gigantic stadium will be built in the Meiji Jingu Gaien. Because Meiji Jingu Gaien is a very sacred place. It's a memorial garden for the Emperor Meiji. And a diet-like building and an entire area was dedicated to the virtue, sacred virtue of Emperor Meiji. So I've just felt that my heart and soul was insulted by that gigantic building. Now, Tokyo Shimbun is a successor of Kokumin Shimbun.
Oh, I see. Yeah.
Business-wise, they took over Kokumin. But they became anti-pre-war Japan campaign paper, denying the former predecessor, Kokumin Shimbun. We still keep the opinion arena of more toward right. But Kokumin Shimbun would like to support you.
Thank you.
And if you permit me, then I'd like to interview you, and I'll put you on the first page. but seriously, this is, I don't think many people do not know, much about the details.
Do you have a question?
Question is, how are you going to, present your ideas to, to general public? Of course, this is one of the best opportunity to, promote, tell your opinion to the world. But
well, when we had a symposium right after Buenos Aires, I said quite a few people came from media. What I asked is to give more news and exposure to this matter, which some of you, like Tokyo Shimbun, did it, which I appreciate very much. So please continue, campaigning against this action. That's it.
Patrick, and then Anthony.
Patrick Sol, Neue Zürcher Zeitung from Switzerland. So you're criticizing this site. Do you have alternatives? And the other question is, well, I guess the powers here in Japan don't really want to change it. But if you look at the IOC, has Tokyo made a promise to build the stadium in this location that way? Or are there ways to change it? Can they go back and say, oh, excuse me, IOC, we now have a different plan?
Well, you see, we might have passed the point of no return in the terms of the site. Now you may not be able to say, well, it's too expensive and so much opposition, now we like to change the site. But at least they could have a different program. After the first estimate came to be $3 billion, expense. So at least, you see, as I said, IOC was not asking to have a retractive roof as such. They only wanted to have 80,000 people to be housed for this Olympic. That's it. And in the case of London, only 25,000 seats for permanent and 55,000 temporary. And the Japan could have that. But some people, I don't know, must have a kind of a face. In Japan, keeping a face is very important, and omotenashi such would not be so easily changed. So I think that we have, I wish you could have more reasons to not add so many facilities to, and I think in expat meeting, there's one person is a music composer, and I understand he proposed this event such as rock concert or a huge sort of a cultural event, which could take place with 80,000 people coming. But in reality, in Japan, we are losing population. We are not upcoming sort of a nation like India or China, and so we should be more modest in our thinking, and even for those cultural event. And so I think some people are saying, why don't we keep existing stadium and to add 20,000 extra seat, and it is one of the things. Or I could say we forget about 80,000 magic number, make only 50,000, and the rest we can make many tents all around the Jingu Gaien or other places. You see, today when we appreciate or we look at World Cup to be take place in a different time zone, we all go into such bars or temporary place where we could enjoy the view on the screen and so on, instead of looking at the athletes from far above. It might be a more reasonable way to do it. So that is my personal sort of option, but there must have been many, many options, but those things are all not really done, because I said this experts meeting generate this idea, and we are on the point of no return, sadly.
Anthony.
Anthony Rowley, Singapore Business Times. One of the guests here last week was Mr. Matsuzoe, who is a candidate in the Tokyo municipal elections. And I asked him a question about whether this was an extravagant Olympics. And his answer rather alarmed me. He said, Tokyo has pots of money, or lots of money. And as a Tokyo taxpayer, I'm a little bit alarmed. It rather reminded me of Mr. Ishihara wanting to buy the Senkaku Islands on behalf of Tokyo. But my question is, can you tell us anything about the financing of this stadium? Yeah. How much of it will be borne by the Tokyo taxpayer? How much of it will be self-financing through various activities? And how much control does the Tokyo Metropolitan Authority have over the process compared to the central government?
Well, how much money Tokyo had depended on who would be elected as Tokyo governor. And so I can't answer to this question in sort of the numbers. But coming back to who is going to pay, I think there must be a negotiation between the national government and some people, organization related sports facilities. They have quite a bit of money right now, and also Tokyo Metropolitan Government. Now, to me, a big question is not for how to satisfy initial cost necessarily for this project, but also who is going to keep this huge project alive for next 50 years. And there must be, I'm sure, some ugly fight between the concerned sort of people, nation, Tokyo Metropolitan Government, and JSC, and so there. I have no really, detail. Ideas or information on how they are going to do it. But you see, they have announced how much income they could get and how much expenditure must be taken for this facility, stadium. And the people, professional people say they can't just believe what they are saying. It's just a face-saving sort of statement. And you see, the building's maintenance cost becomes more expensive as time goes by. This, as an architect, we know. And to me, putting so many things in one building certainly requires more maintenance, not in the building itself, but keeping it through a number of payroll by people and so on. So. It is not things they know so much. As I certainly, Japan has a high level engineering and construction ability, so they might be able to build the Zaha Hadid type building. But I must say, this is a huge monster, can be compared to last dinosaur on the earth. When you look around, there's nobody like you. And to me, today, so many fruitless were fought without any winners. You could look at Sudan, Syria, and even this conflict on the small island on the Japan Sea. And I must say, sadly, the history repeats. No winners. So many wars. So many wars of no winners.
Okay, further questions?
Siegfried Knittel, freelancer from Germany. For me, it seems this kind of design, this kind of architect is a kind of a imperial design. So perhaps it looks like the equivalent of Mr. Abe's dream of a great Japan again. So, but is not Japanese design based on modesty, on wabi value, so very different from imperial great design. More to show every time. Is not to show modesty a very important value in even in the design of Japan?
I think this was an international competition, so there are about 50 or 6 entries. And there must have been a more modest sort of design and among 50s. But the jury members selected this one. And their reason is, since Japan is not now in mood of forward looking, so this might encourage people having this kind of project. So I'm against that. You are against that. So please ask the jury members why you have chosen such a project. And that's it. And you know, architecture is not like arinamin. Arinamin, shitte masu ka? This is a medicine which advertise always. When you get this pills, you become energetic. But in architecture, such things, to me, doesn't exist. And so I'm a little bit puzzled by a statement made by jury members. Yes.
Okay, yes.
So, Elaine Lees, Reuters. So I understand you're, you know, I would take it that you're still not happy. I mean, the government has announced plans to scale back, and especially scale back some of the extra facilities here at the stadium. They want to keep the 80,000 seats no matter what. They say the Olympics requires this. I take it you're, you know, still not happy with the situation as it is now. So can you clarify your views on that, on the government proposal to downsize the stadium? And also, I mean, what would you do? You've mentioned one option, the tents. Is there anything else? Would you take it back to competition?
We don't have time to go back to competition. But coming back to your first question, I think the first question was.
Well, the government has announced plans.
Oh,
to
scale
down.
Yeah, that's right. And after they learned it's too expensive, they scaled down to 80%. 80% of everything hospitality, parking place, museums, etc., etc. But they have never abandoned the original sort of a program, only reduced, and so that's it. And I think as I saw models made according to reduced program, still it looks very huge and fitted to site, so on. And so if Masuzoe wins, I'm sure he go ahead. He goes ahead with this current reduced program, and that's it. And the money could be found somewhere. But the real big question is, after Olympic, it is more. It's a bigger problem, because as you see, from fate of Beijing. Stadium. Who is going to pay for that? Tokyo people or national government? And we don't know yet.
It's 1:30. Can you stay for a few more minutes?
Hmm? Sure, sure. I can.
Okay, our guest has agreed to stay for a few more minutes, but if we could, there was another question she asked. What would you do at this point with this project?
Well, I have said, you know, it may be fighting against losing or without any winners. This must be a right way to express my feeling right now. But as I mentioned to you, after I published this manuscript on concerns, I had so many responses, huge, in email and my replies, and also publications and the newspaper. I think this was unprecedented things in Japan. So while we may be not winning, can have a reasonably modest facility, at least this might have triggered among many people how we should do if same or similar things happen next time. And I think we should remember, and we are trying to publish the book on that, because a book stays, you know, just as long as facility. And so when I publish this book, essays, I receive from unknown professors. He is in economic department of very well-known university, but he happened to be on a sabbatical leave, and he is in Cambridge. And through his cousins, who happened to be an architect, he received this copy. And he immediately wrote back or informed the essay to his colleagues in Japan, including a president of a university. And one of our colleagues said, "What can I do now?" I think this is a first step of sound civil society we like to have. And when I saw the president of this university on an occasion, he immediately mentioned, "I received your essay through my colleague." So in the social media is very strong right now. And I have written this one only for professional people, but immediately through social media, it spread out beyond just the professional people, non-professional and those people and so on. And so I thought, just repeated to say, we may not be able to achieve what I wanted, but at least it triggered these whole events in the last 6 months was to me very exciting for me to know so many people sharing same concerns and opinions.
Other questions? George.
My name is Baumgartner. I'm working for Swiss Television in Tokyo. Is it not possible for you to approach Ms. Zaid, the winner of that project, and to propose to her to work with her to try to downsize the project or to review it. The Tokyo International Forum, you built the Tokyo International Forum with a Uruguayan architect based in New York, Mr. Raffaele. So two architects build the Tokyo International Forum. So why don't you try to approach Ms. Zaid and try to work with her and come with a better project?
No, I don't think the mechanism was made for your proposal. I think the we are well known, people knew that this is a very, very difficult project. So from the beginning, they competition which select not the architect but the design advisor, and Zaha Hadid is a design advisor, and architect Japanese consortium of large firms, and which are now struggling or maybe working with Zaha Hadid, and there is no way I can cut in. So.
Other questions before we go to a second round? Anyone, non-journalists as well, anyone in the room have a question? Okay, right here. Yes, please come up and give your name and affiliation.
Kyoko Onoki from the Times of London. And I'm asking you to know whether there is any chance of you mentioned that the past example happened in Swiss is because it's a civil society, and it seems that you are not regarding Tokyo as a civil society, judging from this result. And is there any chance of you driving starting a kind of referendum movement here in Tokyo?
I think some people are thinking to provide a similar sort of a system now in being operated in England. I just cannot tell you about the details. There is a third man committee to be able to make third person's opinions on such project. And I think now could a governed society would accept such an organization or a function? I don't know, but there are some concerns now, yes, among us professionals.
Okay, other questions right here?
Dobie Chong from London. I have a question, like over some venue in London Olympic. So some of the building was scrapped after the Olympic game. So in Tokyo's situation, some of the like a building considered to be like a demolished. It's like a build and demolished.
You mean a temporary build?
Yeah.
Facility.
Yeah.
I don't know too much about the details of the rest of facilities, and I'm sure some of them must be temporary. But they are building a huge sort of artifacts on Odaiba in water areas. And I don't know too much about it.
Okay, these will be the last two questions, and please keep them brief and to the point, Anthony, and then Siegfried.
Just wonder whether you've had any contact with the political community. In other words, have any politicians supported you, or have they sent you hate mail? What would happen if there were a large earthquake in Tokyo at the time?
Among liberal democratic party, ruling party right now, there's one politician, Mr. Kono, is very sympathetic to whatever we are proposing, but he doesn't have a power against the rest of parties. But there is a politicians who is always devil's advocate in the party and try to cut down the unnecessary expenditure of government. It's a kind of a watchdog. I understand the operator, and they questioned our JSC, nailing down why you have to have that, and they try to avoid the confrontation, and still those people are doing whatever they want. I think this is a nature of bureaucrat, and unless some big politician come and say, let's do something else, I doubt.
Sorry, what would happen if there were a large earthquake in Turkey at the time?
That would be a time that our system will be tested. I think.
Siegfried, and this will be the last question.
Did you try to express your view of of this kind of design and architecture in the TV stations? Is there, perhaps I think Japanese people look, TV is a very important information for Japanese people. So would it be possible to express in TV, some TV station?
I doubt very much about the effect of TV, because you see it also sound by so many people. It give a certain impact. But I think writing, it gives a more lasting impact on this. So I'm giving more concentration on those things.
Okay, we will stop here, and as usual, I get the last word, and I would like to give Mr. Maki a one-year honorary membership to our club. We hope that you will accept this and come back and visit us again.
Thank you
very much.